I bring you greetings from Concordia Theological Seminary in Fort Wayne. It's wonderful to be with all of you here in beautiful Michigan. What a tremendous place this is. And I wish I could stay longer, but I have to leave right after this. I've certainly enjoyed the fellowship with all of you, and it's been a special joy to see former students. And that always brings back great memories. For our study, this is a Bible study. It will be a Bible study in the form of a paper. And originally, as you know, the time slot was going to be for 55 minutes, so I wrote the paper accordingly. Now that the schedule has changed, I have a bit more time, and so I might not go, you know, as fast rushing through it. And that also leaves us a little more time for Q&A, if you so choose. And so we have that flexibility now. But our main portion of Scripture, which we'll be looking at, 1 Kings chapters 17 through 19. We'll be looking at other portions too, but this is the main section. And I believe that there's going to be an outline for you on the screen, and this will help you, you know, follow along the paper. Okay, there's supposed to be, I understood it was going to be an outline too at the tables for you. I guess that's not the situation, but hopefully, oh, right there. Okay, good. They're going to be passed out. Let's start. Let's get moving. And this will be dealing with the prophet Elijah. Elijah was a servant, a prophet of the Lord, who lived in change. He carried out his ministry during a time of change in the northern kingdom of Israel, and he went through changes in his understanding of his own ministry and the effects of his ministry. The change in the northern kingdom that Elijah witnessed and had to deal with occurred when Ahab became ruler of that kingdom. He reigned from around 874 to 853 BC. The northern kingdom was already weak spiritually because its first king, Jeroboam I, who reigned around 931 to 910 BC, had introduced a corrupt form of the worship of Yahweh. He had set up a golden calf in Bethel, the southernmost point of his realm, and at Dan, at the northern end. He presented these images as pedestals on which stood the invisible Yahweh, and thus as alternatives to the Ark of the Covenant in the temple in Jerusalem. Jeroboam also maintained a priesthood, but not the Aaronic priesthood ordained by God. And he kept a religious calendar, but not the one given by God through Moses. Jeroboam introduced these changes for political reasons, so that his subjects would stay loyal to him and not go down to Jerusalem to worship, where they might be won back to the house of David. But all his innovations were contrary to the Torah, and he set the northern kingdom on the wrong spiritual path. As a result, the large majority of the people had incorrect ideas about Yahweh. They were weakened spiritually. Their lives became increasingly wicked. And some even abandoned monotheism and began to practice aspects of pagan idolatry. The situation in the northern kingdom was very bad. But it became more wicked with the ascent of Ahab as king, who had as queen his Phoenician wife, Jezebel. She had imported into the northern kingdom the paganism of her native land, of which the main aspect was the worship of the Canaanite god Baal. Thus, the religion of Baal was at the royal court. Ahab, as prince and then as king, who had been practicing the perverted Yahwism of Jeroboam I, now engaged in something even worse. He actually worshiped and served Baal. 1 Kings chapter 16, verse 31b, due to his marriage to Jezebel. Not only that, Ahab went so far as to build a temple for Baal in Samaria, the capital city of the northern kingdom, and there erect an altar to the deity. 16, verse 32. This indicates, as following chapters in 1 Kings will imply, that Ahab, under the influence of Jezebel, attempted to make Baalism the dominant religion in his kingdom. Not only that, Ahab, in addition, made the Asherah, a pagan cult object associated with the Canaanite goddess Asherah, and perhaps with other female deities, which he set up in Samaria. Chapter 16, verse 33. It can be assumed that Jezebel was the evil force behind Ahab's program and action for changing the religious landscape in his kingdom. Nevertheless, the buck stopped with Ahab, who as king bore the ultimate responsibility. The polytheism of the ancient Near East tolerated the worship of just about any deity. Jezebel and Ahab did not seek to exterminate completely the worship of Yahweh in the form introduced by Jeroboam I in their realm. There were too many of these Yahwehs, those practicing the corrupt Yahwism of the first king of the northern kingdom, too many of these in the land for them to do this. Ahab did not want to stir up to rebellion his subjects who maintained some kind and degree of loyalty to Yahweh. Ahab himself was actually a syncretist, having Baal as his chief god and likely worshiping other Canaanite deities, but not having discarded entirely the Yahwism of Jeroboam the First. Rather, he maintained an amount of recognition of Yahweh as a deity. In fact, Ahab gave his children Yahweh names, that is, names containing an abbreviated form of Yahweh, God's covenant name: Ahaziah, Jehoram, and Athaliah. Further, Ahab allowed to remain standing the worship sites set up by Jeroboam at Bethel and Dan with their golden calves. No doubt Ahab found it entirely acceptable when many of his subjects blended together Yahweh and Baal, seeing them in essence as the same, or when they acknowledged both Yahweh and Baal as deities, as he did. Again, the aim of Jezebel and Ahab was not to eliminate Yahwism, that is, the perverted form of Jeroboam the First, but rather to have Baalism as preeminent. With regard to that goal, Jeroboam's altered Yahwism with its weakened theology would not cause them any problems. Concerning the Yahwism of the Torah, with its staunch confession that Yahweh was the one and only true God, this was another matter. Such a confession and the religion of Baal could not coexist. Jezebel persecuted and killed the genuine prophets of Yahweh. And that's related in 1 Kings chapters 18 and 19. And Ahab allowed her to do this because these prophets proclaimed that Yahweh was the supreme deity, and further, that Yahweh was the only God. Gary Enrig comments, "The insistence of the Lord that he alone was the true God and that he only was to be worshipped, served, and obeyed was intolerable to Jezebel. She hated the God of Moses and Elijah, the one who insisted on exclusive loyalty. The names of the gods have changed, but this is the central issue of our time. Everyone is happy as long as we speak of spirituality and a generic deity. But when we insist on the finality of Jesus' claims, 'I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me,' battle lines are drawn." The reign of Ahab and Jezebel was a major crisis, a deadly threat for Israel, specifically for the northern kingdom. To deal with this altered situation, Yahweh, in his grace, love, and mercy, provided the prophet Elijah for the benefit of his covenant people. In 1 Kings 17, Elijah suddenly, abruptly, dramatically bursts onto the scene and onto the pages of Kings. He does so with all the force and impact of a true prophet of God, sent by the King of the universe on a mission of tremendous importance, bearing the all-powerful word of the Almighty, which he had received directly by inspiration, and delivering this word in a straightforward, fearless manner. He is Yahweh's answer to the campaign of Jezebel and Ahab to make Baalism the dominant religion of the northern kingdom. Elijah proclaimed to Ahab in 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 1, "As Yahweh, the God of Israel, lives, before whom I stand, there will not be these next years dew nor rain except according to my word." What Elijah said to Ahab and what he predicted not only was related to the words of Moses in Leviticus 16 and Deuteronomy chapters 11 and 28, which foretold specific judgments from Yahweh for unfaithfulness to the covenant. This was also a direct assault on the religion of Baal, who, according to the Canaanite belief system, sent the rain and the dew, which was so necessary for life. Elijah speaks of Yahweh, who stated that he was the only God and who had made a covenant with Israel, the nation he chose to bring to fulfillment his redemptive plan for the world. Genuine faith in and worship of Yahweh, not the perverted Yahwism of Jeroboam I, radically differed from Baalism with regard to manner of worship and moral code. It was concerned with far more than merely rainfall and dew and fertility of crops, animals, and humans. Elijah calls Yahweh the God of Israel. Yahweh had been and continued to be the only God of Israel who did not tolerate the worship of any other deity. Now Yahweh was going to show that he alone was God by withholding dew and rain for a period of time. Yahweh would prove that Baal was helpless before him, that in fact, Baal did not exist. This whole message, and that it was delivered forcefully by a courageous messenger, Elijah, whose very name meant, "My God is Yahweh," combined to launch an unmistakable and aggressive counteroffensive to the monarchy's religious program. In your face, Jezebel and Ahab. In 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 1, Elijah announced that there would be neither dew nor rain for a number of years, except according to my word. He identified his word with the word of Yahweh, the real cosmic monarch, whose will was decisive, who controlled everything. Elijah was telling Ahab that he was a genuine prophet of Yahweh, raised up and authorized by Yahweh to be his mouth, his spokesman, who would receive messages directly from Yahweh for delivery to a person and people. Thus begin Elijah's encounters with Ahab, also recorded in 1 Kings 18 and 1 Kings 21. In each of these meetings, the prophet stands as an opponent of the king. Yet it should be recognized that God, by his word which he presented to Ahab by means of Elijah, and by his mighty deeds which involved his prophet, presented again and again the truth to Ahab in a vivid, dramatic manner, in an attempt to bring the king to repentance and to convert him to saving faith. To be sure, the prophet delivered plenty of harsh, fierce law to the king because of his idolatry, but he did so in part also to drive the king to the small amount of gospel that Ahab still knew but had rejected. From the time Yahweh pronounced Genesis 3:15, the worship of Yahweh also included belief in the promised God-man who would be the Savior. Over the following centuries, God gave further information about this deliverer through the messianic prophecies. It can be assumed that even the corrupted Yahwism introduced by Jeroboam I retained a vestige of this messianic hope. Further, Ahab knew what Elijah preached and taught in the northern kingdom. After 3.5 years of total drought, Elijah told Ahab to assemble the prophets of Baal and Asherah, who were supported by Jezebel at the royal court on Mount Carmel, together with representatives of the tribes of the northern kingdom. This Ahab did. There, on Mount Carmel, Elijah set the terms or rules for a contest primarily with the prophets of Baal, who would be supported by the prophets of Asherah. Actually, this would be reckoned as a showdown between Yahweh and Baal by those who believed that both existed. They saw that, although Elijah was a prophet of Yahweh, his arrangements did not favor Yahweh. If anything, they favored Baal. First, many considered Mount Carmel as Baal's territory. Second, according to Canaanite theology, Baal was the storm god who wielded the lightning bolt as his spear. For Baal to send fire from heaven to light the sacrifice would have been an easy thing for him to do, so those who believed in him thought. Third, Elijah gives the prophets of Baal the first choice with regard to the bulls, which would be cut up and placed on the altars as sacrifices. Fourth, Elijah lets the prophets of Baal go first in appealing to their God to send fire from heaven to consume their sacrifice. No doubt the prophets of Baal and Asherah found Elijah's terms completely acceptable. All of this denotes supreme confidence on the part of Elijah, the confidence of a man of strong faith in Yahweh, who had been sent by Yahweh as Yahweh's representative, as to how the contest would turn out. In all probability, Elijah had been directed by Yahweh to set up the contest in this way. After Elijah had set forth the terms of the contest, all the Israelite representatives exclaim, "All right!" They saw that Elijah's terms were sensible, fair, and would result in an obvious and decisive answer to the question, "Who is the God?" Clearly, it would be the deity who sent fire from heaven to consume the sacrifice on his altar, either the altar of the Baal prophets or that of Elijah. One senses that the prophets of Baal and Asherah, and even Ahab, who was there on the mountain and witnessed all that took place, joined their voices to those of the people who said, "All right." We all know how the contest turned out, how Yahweh was the one who sent the awesome fire from heaven, thus decisively showing that he was the God. At such a miraculous demonstration of the omnipotence of Yahweh, all the Israelite representatives could do nothing but fall on their faces in fear and reverence and exclaim twice for emphasis, "Yahweh, he is the God." 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 39. One wonders whether Ahab joined them in that exclamation. With the Israelite representatives firmly and enthusiastically on his side, the victorious side, Elijah has them seize all the prophets of Baal and Asherah and take them down to the Wadi Kishon. A wadi was a ravine or canyon at the bottom of which was a stream or riverbed, which could be dry for much of the year. There, the false prophets were executed according to the directive of Yahweh set forth in Deuteronomy 13, verse 5, and chapter 18, verse 20. Questions arise. Where was Ahab when the prophets were seized and put to death? Did he protest this and exert any effort to stop the slaughter of the men who were so important to his wife and supported by her? What attitude did he have concerning, and what stance did he take toward what happened to these prophets? With regard to these questions, the text supplies very little clear, direct information. One can state with certainty from 1 Kings chapter 18, verses 16 to 46, that Ahab was there on the mountain and witnessed the pagan prophets calling out in vain to Baal, heard the prayer of Elijah, saw the fire of Yahweh coming from heaven with its consuming force, and beheld the prophets being seized and taken from the area. In addition, Ahab had to know the intent of Elijah with his ordering the people to lay hold of the prophets forcibly and having them brought down the mountain. The text gives no hint of Ahab protesting their seizure or trying to prevent their slaughter. Where the text is silent, one must exercise caution. Yet it is legitimate to propose that Ahab realized any voicing of disagreement and issuing of a negative command and any attempted preventative action would have been useless on his part. There were too many Israelite representatives, and they were too fired up for Yahweh and his prophet Elijah. Something else can be suggested. Ahab, after seeing the utter failure of Baal, whom he thought would gain vindication there on Mount Carmel in vengeance against Elijah, and the vivid, magnificent display of Yahweh's might, was so overwhelmed emotionally and mentally that he was unwilling and or unable to say or do anything to counteract Elijah's plan with regard to the pagan prophets. The impression Yahweh's tremendous triumph had on Ahab should not be underestimated. This syncretist, who previously had Baal as his chief god, now was in inner turmoil, confused, forced to see Baal and Yahweh in a new and different way. This could be another reason why Ahab might have offered no objection to or put up any resistance to Elijah's plan, and why he might have accompanied the crowd down to the Wadi Kishon, and why he might have watched in silence as the 850 prophets sponsored by his wife were slain. That Ahab went down to the Wadi could be indicated by Elijah's directive to him in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 41. Go up, eat, and drink. Ahab, it seems, was to go up from the Wadi to where he had been on Mount Carmel, where his camp had been set up, and there eat and drink. Why did Elijah say to Ahab, go up, eat and drink, for listen, the rush of rain? Was the prophet being sarcastic or indirectly mocking the king? This paper proposes that Elijah was being serious and that he uttered these words with an enthusiastic happiness because he thought that Ahab, after what transpired on Mount Carmel, had been converted to true Yahwism. The suggestion was made previously that Yahweh's triumph did have a major impact on Ahab and that he was forced to have a new perspective regarding Yahweh and Baal. Now, an additional proposal is that Elijah was partly correct. In other words, the Carmel event did change Ahab to a certain extent. Possible evidence for this will be discussed in connection with 1 Kings 19. Concerning subsequent chapters in Kings, consider that Ahab listens to a true prophet of Yahweh and follows his advice. 1 Kings chapter 20, verses 13 through 21. He listens to another genuine prophet of Yahweh, and though this prophet speaks a word of judgment, Ahab does nothing to him. 1 Kings chapter 20, verses 41 to 43. Ahab recognizes a Torah stipulation and does not take Naboth's vineyard from him by force. 1 Kings 21, verses 1 through 4. When Elijah pronounces a severe word of condemnation and coming punishment, Ahab does not harm the prophet and instead tears his clothes, puts on sackcloth, fasts, and humbles himself before Yahweh. 1 Kings 21, verses 20 through 29. 1 Kings 22, verses 4 through 6, relates that, at least by the time the events of chapter 22 take place, Ahab has about 400 prophets of Yahweh at his court. 1 Kings 22 also indicates that the location of a true prophet of Yahweh, Micaiah, was known. yet he had not been slain by Jezebel. Was Ahab actually converted to true Yahwism, which was not the Yahwism of Jeroboam the First? In a word, no. Briefly, two pieces of evidence for this are that the 400 Yahweh prophets at his court are, as 1 Kings 22 makes clear, not true prophets of the Lord, and that Ahab rejects the message of Micaiah and has him thrown into prison. It is proposed that Elijah, however, incorrectly thinks that Ahab has been brought to saving faith. In Elijah's mind, this has resulted from Yahweh's victory on the mountain, which the prophet concludes has driven Ahab to the gospel, which he had been taught and heard through a felicitous inconsistency at earlier periods in his life, perhaps even hearing the preaching of Elijah, and which Ahab still remembered. Through this gospel, Elijah believes Ahab has now been converted. So Elijah, in all seriousness, tells Ahab to eat and drink, for it was about to rain again after 3.5 years of no precipitation. Ahab could indeed have been hungry, since some time might have passed since his last meal. The intent of Elijah's words, though, is not only to have the king deal with hunger, but also to celebrate, to engage in a feast of rejoicing, because the end of the drought was near. This new convert, as Elijah judged him to be, is to exalt in his new relationship with Yahweh, and in Yahweh's demonstration of favor toward his kingdom soon to take place. And Ahab does follow Elijah's orders to eat and to drink. Elijah speaks of the rush of rain, and one recalls what the prophet said to Ahab in 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 1. There will not be these next years dew nor rain except according to my word. Now Yahweh's prophet says there will be rain, proving that Yahweh is the Lord of life and fertility. With a great storm approaching, Elijah instructs his attendant to say to Ahab, "Hitch up and go down, so the rain will not hinder you." 1 Kings 18, verse 44. Elijah, according to the interpretation of this paper, genuinely is trying to help the king by giving him this advice. The prophet knows that it is time for Ahab to leave Carmel, and he apparently was aware of the king's destination, Jezreel, where the king has a palace, and which was much closer to Carmel than Samaria, the capital city. Ahab is to get his chariot and horses ready and descend from the mountain and cross the Wadi Kishon before the coming downpour would make such preparation and descent difficult and such a crossing dangerous due to the flooding of the Wadi. Thus, Ahab rides to Jezreel. 1 Kings 18:46 reports God giving Elijah supernatural strength and endurance. The hand of Yahweh was on Elijah so that he can run the 27 plus miles from Mount Carmel to Jezreel and do this preceding Ahab in his chariot. Yahweh enables his prophet to carry out such an extraordinary physical feat in order to give further testimony to Ahab, in addition to the revelation on Mount Carmel, as to who is the God, and that Elijah is his authorized spokesman. Elijah, no doubt, grasps this as he hastens before Ahab's chariot to Jezreel. Yet he also thinks, incorrectly, that he is running before a converted king. In previous examples of runners going before a chariot, involving Absalom, 2 Samuel chapter 15, verse 1, and Adonijah, another son of David, 1 Kings chapter 1, this had been done to indicate the coming of a man, the one riding in the chariot, who wanted to be king, and to show and elicit support for his kingly ambition. One reason Elijah has for running before Ahab's chariot is to indicate the coming of the man who already was king and to show and elicit respect and support for him, thus giving encouragement to the king, whom Elijah believes is now a monotheistic Yahwist. This paper suggests that Elijah was joyful and excited as he went before Ahab's chariot, since he eagerly, but erroneously, anticipated the king putting an end to Baalism, carrying on a religious reformation in his realm, and promoting true Yahwism. With this understanding of the prophet's mindset, the reader is prepared for what will be reported in 1 Kings chapter 19. What transpired on Mount Carmel and in the Wadi Kishon and the ensuing rainstorm indeed have had a major psychological and emotional impact on Ahab. 1 Kings 19 reports that upon coming to Jezreel, he relates to Jezebel all that had happened. And the impression given by the Hebrew text is that an awestruck Ahab gives Jezebel a thorough report. In turn, the news delivered by Ahab profoundly affects Jezebel, but in a different way. Reacting quickly and filled with fury, she sends a messenger to Elijah to proclaim her oath that about that time tomorrow, she will kill him. Listening to the messenger, Elijah must have been stunned by what he has to say, and Elijah becomes afraid. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 3. Verse 3 involves a major text-critical issue, namely, whether Elisha saw or was afraid. We do not have the time to go through the discussion of this matter. Let me just say that because of testimony from some Hebrew manuscripts, the Septuagint, the Syriac, and the Vulgate, and because of evidence from other passages in the Hebrew Bible, I am convinced that the original reading was Elijah was afraid. In other words, he panicked. Fearing for his life, he hastily leaves Jezreel and the northern kingdom and goes far south into the southern kingdom to Beersheba. How could it be that the great prophet Elijah, who had shown himself as fearless in 1 Kings chapters 17 and 18, now is afraid? Various reasons can be ventured in answer to that question. Number one, Elijah had hoped and expected that after what had taken place in 1 Kings 18, there would be a tremendous religious reformation in the northern kingdom, headed by Ahab and supported by many members of his realm. He looked forward to a profound, immediate, and visible change in the kingdom. Elijah now realizes that such a reformation will not take place and that Jezebel remains firmly in power, and he believes just as much an evil threat as before, if not more so. This is the first time that an exercise of the power of Yahweh has not had the desired effect as far as Elijah is concerned. Before, Yahweh's omnipotence had brought about the drought for which Elijah had prayed, had caused the ravens to feed Elijah, had provided Elijah, the widow, and her children with enough food, had brought the widow's son back from death to life, had caused fire to fall from heaven to consume Elijah's sacrifice altar and lick up the water that was around the altar, had caused the people to proclaim, Yahweh, he is the God, and had brought the rainfall. But Yahweh's power did not bring about the reformation. Number two, coupled with this is the fact that now, when he is in great danger, Elijah receives no word from Yahweh as to what he should do. Elijah always before had acted and was directed by a word from God. This is assumed for 1 Kings 17:1, when Elijah announces to Ahab the coming drought. Then the phrase, the word of Yahweh came to him or came to Elijah, appears three times. In 1 Kings 17:2, God tells Elijah to hide in the Wadi Cherith. In verse 8, God tells Elijah to go to Zarephath and stay in the widow's house. And in chapter 18, verse 1, God tells Elijah to present himself to Ahab. Now, such a word from Yahweh is absent. Number three, Elijah had thought that specifically Ahab had been changed by the Carmel event. In fact, had been converted to true monotheistic Yahwism. When Jezebel's message came to him, the prophet realizes that he had been wrong in his thinking. That realization, with accompanying shock, contributes to his fear. He perceives the enormity of the wickedness still remaining with the royal house. These are not excuses for Elijah becoming afraid. There's no issue with Elijah fleeing for his life, which, it could be argued, was a matter of self-preservation. Noticeable is what the narrative does not report, that in this time of crisis, Elijah comforted himself with and was strengthened by Scripture, and that he went to the Lord in prayer. The bottom line is that while Elijah was a man of strong faith, his faith needed further refining. He had wisdom, but needed further growth in wisdom. Because things did not turn out as he, a godly man zealous for the Lord, had planned, had wanted, had thought, and because he misunderstood or did not fully comprehend aspects of the present reality following the Mount Carmel event, he gave in to fear. What did Elijah misunderstand or not completely grasp and understand? Following are suggested points for consideration. Number one, what had transpired on Carmel and in the Wadi Kishon and the storm which followed had exactly the effects that Yahweh wanted. These did not match what Elijah desired and expected, the total elimination of Baalism from the land, and the return of all Israelites of the northern kingdom to the true worship of Yahweh. But the prophet had to learn to pray, "Not my will, but your will, Lord, be done." He had to be reminded that God's will is perfect, that God's will always will be accomplished, and that one often does not see the accomplishment of God's will. The Lord wanted to and did present the truth to many Israelites, including Ahab. This had an impact lasting beyond that moment when the people cried out, "Yahweh, he is the God." Yahweh's victory on the mountain and his sending the rain served to strengthen the faith of all those believers in the northern kingdom of whom Elijah was unaware, and to give them encouragement in their faith. Further, one can assume that a number of those who lacked saving faith had now been driven to recall the gospel which they had heard from genuine prophets of Yahweh and were brought or restored to faith. Also, a seed had been planted in the hearts of some of those who still remained unbelievers, which could lead to a harvest later in the ministry of Elijah or Elisha. Number two, Elijah failed to grasp, as Ingrid writes, that, quote, "victory in one battle does not mean that the war is over," close quote. Number three, though not converted to monotheistic Yahwism, Ahab has been changed by the events related in 1 Kings 18, as previously discussed. As a result, he has taken a different stance toward Elijah and now exercises some restraint on his wife Jezebel so that she could not operate as before the contest on Carmel. From all indications, he must have told her not to kill Elijah, and that the slaying of genuine Yahweh prophets, those who opposed the worship of Baal, had to come to an end. Consider that the location of Elijah is known. he has preceded Ahab's chariot to Jezreel, and the gatekeepers and others know where the prophet is. Yet Elijah is not immediately captured, though Ahab, prior to the Carmel event, had been desperately searching for him for over 3 years. 1 Kings 18, verses 9 through 12. Jezebel is able to send a messenger to Elijah, but only a messenger, and not a contingent of soldiers to arrest him. She threatens to kill him, but to do this the next day, or by the next day. Why tomorrow, and not immediately, the same day as the delivery of the message? Evidently, Ahab has forbidden her from harming the prophet, but she plans to work on her husband and persuade him to change his mind, which she feels she can soon accomplish by tomorrow. Or, realizing that she cannot lay a finger on Elijah, she hopes then to scare him off and out of her kingdom. And so she phrases her oath as she does. In this she succeeds. Elijah, stunned by the message from Jezebel and giving in to panic, flees with his attendant for his life. Although, as just discussed, his life really was not in danger. Far out of the kingdom of Ahab and Jezebel, as already mentioned, well to the south, to Beersheba of the southern kingdom. After leaving his attendant there, he proceeds alone. He does so because he simply needs to be by himself. Because what will transpire and what he will say is to be between only Yahweh and the prophet. And because he wants to die. By now, Elijah is physically exhausted due to fleeing from Jezreel to Beersheba, and also emotionally exhausted. The surge of adrenaline has died down. His fear has somewhat lessened. Disappointment has set in, and he becomes discouraged and demoralized. He thinks that his entire prophetic ministry, which has shown such power and promise, has been for nothing, that it has been a complete failure. Despondent, he has lost hope and gives up. In essence, he says to God, "Take this prophetic ministry from me, which has been such a burden and caused such hardship and has been so unsuccessful. I don't want it anymore. In fact, I do not want to go on living." Elijah pleads, "Take my life." Walter Kaiser speaks for many church workers when he writes, "Frequently, we too have plunged from tremendous heights where we experience the power and spiritual energy of the living God down to the depths of despair." Elijah's discouragement, despondency, and desire for death are due in part to his incorrect judgment, misperception, not seeing everything, and thinking that his plan for the northern kingdom was the only way. Yet it was wrong for him to fall into such a condition. Paul wrote in Philippians 4, verse 4, "Rejoice in the Lord always, which was and is God's will for all believers of all times and places." As Charles Spurgeon said, "The best of men, at best, are only men." In addition, if, as Elijah thought, he was the only true prophet of Yahweh left in the northern kingdom, that was a strong reason for him to want to live. His life and ministry, as Spurgeon notes, were then most needed in his land. Yahweh, the sensitive, compassionate, loving, gracious, and merciful God, will now minister to his minister. He will bring about necessary change in Elijah. First, Yahweh sends an angel to give wonderful food to the prophet, which miraculously sustained Elijah for 40 days and 40 nights. Then Yahweh has a meeting with Elijah on Mount Horeb or Sinai. God, so to speak, set the prophet up for this encounter. Elijah had received no word from Yahweh, but not because God erred or committed a mistake. Rather, God sent his word when he wanted, and his timing was always perfect. God's delay in sending a message to Elijah, in part, was necessary chastening of the prophet, who unknowingly and ironically had separated himself somewhat from the Lord, as will be discussed. This chastening, though, would produce, to use the words of the author of Hebrews, chapter 12, 11, the peaceful fruit of righteousness. Elijah would come to recognize anew the utmost importance of continually, constantly holding closely to the Lord and grasping his word in faith. God could foresee that Elijah, not having a divine word, would flee from the northern kingdom and head far to the south. That was exactly what God wanted. Yahweh intended to meet with Elijah on Horeb, as he had with Moses, and the prophet's flight would put him closer to that location. Also, the Lord knew that his servant needed a counseling session. God willed that Elijah leave the kingdom of Ahab and Jezebel so that the prophet could take a break from his work and from the territory where he had labored, resulting in Elijah being free from any pressure. In that different setting, Elijah would let it all out before the Lord. Something else that would lead to this full outpouring of the prophet was his present emotional and psychological state. He was not only discouraged and despondent, but also bitter. This reaction of Elijah's sinful nature was partly a result of God's not sending him a message, which in turn, as noted, was to a certain extent chastening from the Lord. Elijah, however, also because of this inner condition and with the right prompting, would move into a complete self-disclosure of his thoughts and feelings, which had to happen if he was to receive counseling from Yahweh. He would then be ready to learn from the Lord. Thus, God's not sending Elijah a message ultimately resulted in Elijah being in exactly the place and condition which would be conducive to his receiving help. 1 Kings 19:9 relates that after Elijah had spent a night in a cave on Horeb, a word of Yahweh at last came to him. It arrived in the form of a question. With the query, "What brings you here, Elijah?" God was not giving the prophet a cloaked rebuke, nor was he seeking information. As previously indicated, Yahweh knew why, and in fact, Elijah presently stood on the mountain according to what the Lord wanted and planned. God asked the question to get the prophet to open up and speak his mind. This was the prompting that would result in Elijah pouring out his heart and soul before Yahweh, which in turn formed the context for God proceeding to help the prophet and lead him to greater wisdom. Elijah's response to the Lord, recorded in 1 Kings 19, verse 10, lets the reader see into his heart and mind. "I have been truly zealous for Yahweh, God of hosts. Indeed, the children of Israel have abandoned your covenant, your altars they have torn down, and your prophets they have killed with the sword. But I have remained, I alone, and they have sought to take my life." That he starts out talking about himself and ends that way is telling. Elijah indeed had been very zealous for the Lord, but the prophet had started to focus too much on himself. He had moved from thinking, "See how the Lord is using me, and see what God has done," to, "Look how zealous I have been for Yahweh, and look what I have done for God," from, "It all depends on God," to, "It all depends on me." R.D. Patterson and Herman Ostell comment that Elijah took his own importance too seriously. Jerome Walsh writes that Elijah's preoccupation with himself overshadows, or at least equals, his concern for God's own glory. Viewing what he judged to be disappointing results, Elijah thought, "I have failed. I did not get the results that I worked for and I hoped for." Simon de Vries notes that there can be little doubt but that the Elijah of our narrative is so weak and filled with despair because he has cut himself off, that is, distanced himself unknowingly from the fountain of his strength, the God of Israel, who is also the God of heaven and earth. Elijah has moved from trusting totally in the Lord and his might more toward depending on himself and his own zeal and spiritual strength, thus distancing himself from God. This means also that Elijah has separated himself somewhat from Scripture, or not taken into consideration the whole counsel of Scripture, the Word of God. De Vries concludes, "All that he can remember that is positive is his own prophetic authority and authenticity." Depressed, Elijah has fallen into feeling sorry for himself and also into a way of thinking which is somewhat skewed and are not completely accurate. He refers to the children of Israel. Elijah is wrong in his assessment of the situation in the northern kingdom. Although he believes otherwise, not everyone there had abandoned the covenant, was guilty of tearing down Yahweh's altars and of killing his prophets, and was seeking to take Elijah's life. He was forgetting about those people on Mount Carmel who had proclaimed, after fire came down from heaven, "Yahweh, he is the God." Granted, a majority of the people had forsaken the covenant, but not the entire population. Agents of Jezebel had murdered the prophets and probably had torn down the altars. As far as one can tell from the biblical text, Jezebel is the only one wanting to execute Elijah, and she likely is not a real threat to accomplish that. Further, Elijah does not remain by himself as the only true prophet of Yahweh left in the northern kingdom. He should not have said this, because he has recently been informed in 1 Kings 18 that 100 such prophets have secretly been hidden in two caves and supplied with nourishment. Yahweh, in order to help and teach Elijah in his time of need, and knowing just what was necessary, grants Elijah the awesome privilege of a theophanic experience. The prophet told to come out of the cave and stand before Yahweh would have a special encounter with Yahweh. He is informed that the Lord will be passing by. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 11. But how? In what mode? Not in a great and mighty wind, not in an earthquake, and not in a fire. Then there is a voice, a low whisper. 1 Kings 19, verse 12. Yahweh is associated with this voice. It is his voice. Yahweh is finally passing by. Elijah realizes this, and as a result, he covers his face by wrapping it in his mantle out of reverence before the Lord. Why did Yahweh have Elijah go through the experience with the wind, the quaking, and the fire, and then manifest his presence to the prophet with the voice, the low whisper? The Lord is teaching his servant that he, the Almighty, when he chooses, can deal with people through awesome displays of his might and majesty, as he had in the time of Moses at the sea and at Mount Sinai, and as he had on Mount Carmel in the ministry of Elijah just weeks earlier. Yet Yahweh's usual way of operating was through his word. As Peter Lighthart puts it, 1 Kings 19 emphasizes that Yahweh is more fundamentally associated with his word than with any other phenomena. This word might seem simple, weak, and lowly to the unbelieving world, but God, with all his divine attributes, accompanies his word, is present in it, and through his word quietly, in unspectacular fashion, yet most effectively brings about tremendous results. Another observation is that this was an external word, which Elijah heard with his ears. When God communicated with his prophets, he could do so internally, putting his word in their hearts and minds, or externally by speaking audible words to them. With the formulaic expression, "the word of God came to a prophet," there is often no indication as to how exactly the word was communicated to and received by the prophet. Certainly, when God inspired his prophets with the result that they wrote down his word, this was often, if not usually, an internal process. Passages in the New Testament lead to such an understanding. For example, Paul writes in 1 Timothy 3:16, "All scripture is God-breathed." Peter states in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 10 through 11, "Concerning this salvation, prophets sought and searched out diligently who were prophesying concerning the grace coming to you, investigating what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them was revealing, predicting the sufferings in store for Christ and the glories after these." Peter also says in his second epistle, chapter 1, verse 21, "For not by the will of man was prophecy ever produced, but men borne along or carried, phenomenoi, by the Holy Spirit spoke from God." This passage lends itself to the idea of the Spirit giving the prophets internal revelation, putting thoughts in their minds, leading them in that way to speak and record the word of God. In a mysterious, miraculous fashion, they were carried along, not to be understood in a physical sense, by the Spirit. In this verse, Peter does not use the verbs speak or dictate with reference to the activity of the Spirit. In 1 Kings 19, verse 12, however, the voice, a low whisper, is external to Elijah. God thus indicates that his usual way of operating with people, a different matter than his inspiring the prophets, is through his word. Specifically, this is his word which comes or exists outside of them, in which he does not communicate internally within them. This is the word that people heard the prophets proclaim. Also, it is the written, recorded word of God, which the people would hear read to them, or which they could read themselves. In addition, it was the word joined to circumcision and sacrifice, making those acts Old Testament sacraments, just as the word of God connected with water and bread and wine produces the New Testament sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper. This objective external word the people could memorize and store in their heart. While Elijah stands at the cave entrance, a voice comes to him again and repeats the question just asked. "What brings you here, Elijah?" 1 Kings 19, verse 13. The voice is that of Yahweh, the one speaking with Elijah. This voice, perhaps, had a different sound, maybe louder, more distinct, than the voice mentioned at the end of verse 12. The author of Kings uses the word voice in verse 13 in light of verse 12 and with the same significance as in verse 12 concerning externality. God a second time asks Elijah, "What brings you here?" for the same reason as in 1 Kings 19, verse 9, to prompt the prophet to pour out his thoughts and feelings before the Lord. Elijah does so, 1 Kings 19, verse 14, repeating the words he spoke in 1 Kings 19, verse 10. God's ultimate purpose with this prompting thus is accomplished. With his second and identical response, Elijah has thoroughly emptied himself out. Now God, in giving his spoken response to Elijah can work a thorough change in the prophet. He will do so by speaking audibly with Elijah, specifically by presenting law and gospel to his servant. Elijah will be a parade example of how God operates with people and brings about remarkable results through his external word. Yahweh's response makes up the rest of the narrative, 1 Kings 19, verses 15 through 18. At first glance, it seems as if God brushes aside Elijah's complaint about the children of Israel and the prophet's self-pitying, yet in reality, God deals with both. The underlying message is that Elijah's complaint is wrong and that he should stop feeling sorry for himself. Because of time, we can consider only the gospel portion of God's reply to Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 18. But I preserve in Israel 7,000, all the knees which have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth which has not kissed him. Though he did not think so, Elijah had fellow believers in the northern kingdom, people who had, in fact, never worshipped Baal or shown him any veneration. It may also be assumed from the phraseology chosen by Yahweh, I preserve in Israel, that these people had no association with the perverted Yahwism of Jeroboam I. Rather, they held faithfully to the covenant which God established with Israel through Moses, lived godly lives, and looked forward to the coming Messiah. God preserved them in saving faith through his word. They were the proof that Yahweh is more fundamentally associated with his word than with any other phenomena. These believers continued to exist because of their hearing, reading, and learning scripture, and because of the preaching and teaching of Elijah and the other true prophets. They were the result God, in large measure through the prophet's ministry, wanted to and did achieve, quietly, yet by his almighty power. The news about the 7,000 must have startled Elijah, leading to him to understand that he did not know or see everything. Elijah might have wanted a higher number, but it corresponded exactly to God's plan. Moreover, this group consisted of those who had never worshipped Baal. Elijah now realized that there could be additional genuine believers in the realm of Ahab and Jezebel, those who previously had venerated Baal, but who later had been brought to saving faith in Yahweh and were being preserved in that faith by God. The prophet also understood that God could and would add to the total number of believers in the future. All this was or would be the reality because of the quiet yet tremendous effectiveness of God's word, specifically the gospel, which is the power of God for salvation. Yahweh allowed Elijah to go through a trauma as a cathartic experience. He has been refined. As Job, Elijah emerges from a crisis, a changed man, humbler and spiritually stronger and wiser. He has come to understand, to use the words of Enrig, that ministry success did not necessarily mean achieving the final result. It did mean completing his God-given assignment. Elijah has adjusted his expectations so he could rejoice in what God had accomplished through him. God brought Elijah out of his depression so that, I firmly believe, Elijah leaves Horeb rejuvenated, recharged, so to speak, with renewed zeal for the Lord. Yahweh has more work for him to do, which Elijah now is determined to carry out in the strength of the Lord, empowered through what God has spoken to him. This man, who had wanted to die, realizes that God's plan for him was far better. God answered Elijah's prayer, "Take my life," not as the prophet had requested, but in the best possible way. Elijah, it may be assumed, recognizes how graciously Yahweh has dealt with him. Yahweh the God of salvation, who would send the Messiah. Though the prophet had erred, God did not cast him aside, but ministered to him, changed him, renewed him, and would continue to use him as his servant. Some concluding comments, very few. Number one, change, as we know, is inevitable. One of the constants in life is change. Often change is beyond our control. This might include, for example, changes in our circumstances or changes in our society. Sometimes changes which must take place cannot be blamed on us and/or do not involve us. At other times, such changes are our fault and/or do involve us. These kinds of changes might be necessary because of mistakes we have made, because of misunderstandings that we have, or because of plans or goals we have that do not match God's plans and goals. Number two, with regard to our work as pastors, let us trust God to bring about the changes which, for whatever reason, are necessary. Why will God do this? Because he wants to advance the work of the church, because he loves all people, because Jesus died for all, and because God desires the salvation of all. He is a God of economy, not wasting time or his ministers or their talents and abilities which he has given them. God will see to it that the needed alterations occur so that his will is accomplished. Think of how God patiently but effectively caused crucial changes in the apostles with regard to their thinking and understanding concerning the real nature of the Messiah's kingdom and concerning Gentiles being included in that kingdom. And number three, with regard to necessary changes in us pastors and in our ministry, let us be, of course, in the word and prayer. God speaks to us through his word. Very simply, God through his word will grant us wisdom, strength, and courage. And he, for Jesus' sake, will answer our prayers for guidance and help. Of course, God could use a brother pastor or brother pastors or astute lay people firmly grounded in scripture to give us advice we need. In these and other ways, God will accomplish in us and our work proper and beneficial change, which will be to his glory and for the benefit of those we serve. Thank you for your attention.